Well, friends, good morning to all the members of both the sister organizations, the Bombay Chartered Accountant Society and the Chamber of Tax Consultants, and all our online viewers. And welcome to this lecture meeting on the future of the CA profession post-COVID 2019, a perspective. We also have with us today our Joint Secretary Samir Kapadia and Managing Committee members Chirag and Kinjal, who will be playing host to this particular meeting. Friends, over the years, both our organizations have been disseminating knowledge to its members and community as large. And the unique selling point for both these organizations have been its events, be it lecture meeting, seminars, workshop, residential courses, long duration courses, or its publications. Well, the chamber had got active into organizing webinars, but we entered into this platform very late. And I'm happy and proud to inform that both these organizations have converted this challenge into an opportunity, and we are doing very good. We are disseminating knowledge to our members from outside Bombay, where they are happy to connect with us on a regular basis. Friends, we all know that these are difficult and testing times, but we all are fighters, and we are used to this hardship right from the beginning, from our students' day. Right from the day we did our articleship, we were managing our articleship, study, balancing our personal life all at the same time. So I'm confident of since the last 1 month, we have adapted to the new work culture with the restrictions on the movement. So we are all working smartly from home. Friends, you will also see that in the last few, since the past week, all the main listed companies have come out with the audited results as on schedule. Big mega mergers and acquisition deals are happening, like the one with Jio and Facebook, and more recently, the Axis Bank with Max Insurance. This means a lot of our fellow professionals are working. They're working harder. In fact, I think on a personal note, I think that I'm much more busier than what I was from office. And I'm sure this is the same with many of us. Even the small and medium firms have adopted, and work is happening. A lot depends on how our clients are also coping up with this reality. Friends, what is the current global scenario? Where does India stand in this situation? Will normalcy ever return? If it returns, then when? What things will be the same again? What is in store for our profession in future? Where will be maybe 6 months down the line or 3 years down the line? What strategy to adopt for survival and growth moving forward? What innovations will be required? What are the new skill sets and the mindset, more importantly, that we will require? What will be the opportunities? How would we consolidate and collaborate our practices? And to answer all these questions and much more, we have Dinesh Bhai today with us. Thank you, Dinesh Bhai, once again to agree to join us today. And I would just request Dinesh Bhai, when he starts, to instruct how this lecture meeting has to be proceeded. So with these words, I welcome all of you once again. Thank you, Dinesh Bhai, to be with us. And with these words, I would request President of the Chamber of Tax Consultant, Vipul Bhai, to introduce Dinesh Bhai formally. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Manish. I welcome all the delegates on behalf of both the organization. It's indeed a pleasure to host one of the very useful, I would say, lecture meeting by a very eminent professional. I'm sure you all are taking good care of you and your family. Friends, you all would agree that we are passing through one of the toughest time of our lifetime, and the entire mankind is affected due to COVID-19. And our profession is also equally affected. Therefore, both the organization thought that we must have a lecture meeting by somebody who is as eminent as Dinesh Bhai Kanabar. And I'm sure with his vast knowledge that he has, we all would be immensely benefited. Friends, everyone knows Dinesh Bhai. He's a chartered accountant of great eminence. But everyone need to know about his achievement and about his illustrious profile. Therefore, I will briefly introduce Dinesh Bhai. Dinesh Bhai has been recognized by his peers as among the top tax advisors in India. His ability to relate the business strategies of clients to the tax and regulatory environment has been recognized as unique and has played a critical role in developing solutions for clients. Prior to founding Dhruva, as you all know that he is the founder partner of Dhruva and currently is the CEO. Prior to founding Dhruva, he held a series of leadership positions across several large professional service organizations in India. He was a deputy CEO of KPMG India, chairman of KPMG's tax practice, deputy CEO of RSMN company, and head tax and regulatory at PricewaterhouseCoopers. He is currently a member of the National Executive Committee of FICCI and is a former chairman of its taxation committee. Dinesh Bhai is currently a mentor to the taxation committee of FICCI. He has also worked with Government of India on several policy committees. He was a member of Rangachari committee constituted by the Prime Minister of India to deal with tax reforms in the IT sector and for evolving safe harbor rules. With this brief introduction, I welcome Dinesh Bhai and thank you Dinesh Bhai for making it despite your very busy schedule, and over to you Dinesh Bhai for your talk. Thank you.
Good morning to everybody. Thank you Mitesh, thank you Vipul Bhai for the kind introduction and for this opportunity to chat up with the members of both the illustrious professional bodies, the Bombay Chartered Accountants Society and the Chamber of Tax Consultants. You know, as I start to talk to you about the future of the profession, the two things which come to my mind first and foremost is that, as you all know, when we look at the institutes, the act and the second schedule, which speaks about professional misconduct. The first professional misconduct, one of the earliest, is to talk about a chartered accountant in practice, giving his signature to an estimate of earnings, which is contingent upon future transactions and vouching for the accuracy. So the first thing which came to my mind was that, how do I really talk about the future of a profession? Because signing off on the future of the profession could be a gross violation and a misconduct, and you would fall foul of the institute's regulations. What I'm trying to do here today is to provide you a perspective of how I see COVID impacting us. How do I see the need for the profession to reorient itself, to regear itself? And again, we are dealing with a situation which is very, very fluid. As we go along, we'll talk about how fluid is the situation. And if the situation is this fluid, people are not aware of what is in store. Again, how does one plan for the future? And one thing which I am reminded always is of age-old adage, which says that hope cannot be a strategy. You cannot just be hoping that future will be right. You got to anticipate the future. You got to think about the future. You got to adapt to the future. And those who do that are able to conquer the adversities that come in. So let's begin our presentation today. I'm going to talk to you for the next 1 hour about four aspects. What is the current economic situation? What is the current business environment? How do I see the impact on the profession? And therefore, what I see are the takeaways. I intend to speak for about an hour or so, and then we'll have a question answer. You can put your questions on the chat box and I will leave it to the moderator to thereafter pick up the questions and put them to me. And we'll close this presentation at 12:30 as is scheduled. Let me begin with my current thoughts. So here is the current assessment of the economic situation. And as you can see how things are changing. So for example, we start talking about the global scenario, and we all know that the International Monetary Fund has named the current situation, or is calling the current situation, the worst recession since the Great Depression. And there are a variety of estimates of the loss of global GDP. The numbers are odious. Beyond a point of time, you cannot even measure the zeros in the numbers that come in. And we are looking at a loss of around USD 9 trillion. We are looking at global merchandise trade contracting by as much as potentially a third. We have seen, for example, how oil prices have crashed. And we looked at negative pricing of oil for the futures. But leaving the futures aside, even the current price of oil at between $10 and $15 a barrel is something which nobody would have in the wildest dream imagined to be the reality of the situation. I was talking to a managing partner of one of the leading firms in New York, which specializes in restructuring. And I was just trying to understand from him back there as to what was the situation like. And he made a statement which was rather startling. He said that, Dinesh, the amount of bankruptcy filings and the amount of restructuring that is happening in USA at this point of time is so huge that we are blocked out for our capacity for the next 18 months. Meaning that if we get one more assignment, we can deal with it only 18 months from now. And as you know, the situation has not even evolved fully. We are still in the initial stages or mid stages of COVID. And this is a situation which is right out there. And you could speak to any partner in a big four accounting firm, and they will come back with the very same answer that they are full up in terms of restructuring, stress, and how do organizations need to reorganize themselves on a going forward basis. We have read this morning, for example, how a British Airways has started shedding jobs. We have seen how some of the retail chains have furloughed employees, etc. So we are fairly aware of the global scenario. And you look at the Indian scenario, my slide here, which was drafted yesterday, speaks about the growth going down from 5.8% to 1.9%. And I'm sure all of you, when you woke up this morning, would have seen the revised estimates of anywhere between 0.2 to 0.8%. So we are looking at India probably just clinging on tenuously to a positive growth. Will it happen? Will it not happen? I don't know. I'm not an economist. I can't predict how the India's growth will be. But as we can see, it's going to be from a 7.5% growth, we went down to 6%, 5.5%, 5.8% thereabouts, and we are now talking about barely being positive. There are various estimates as to whether post this current year, which is sort of looking like a washout, could be actually a degrowth in GDP. Will Indian economy bounce back? IMF has projected a V-shaped recovery, and has said that post 2021, in 21-22 financial year, will grow at about 7.4%. Will that happen? I don't know. It's very, very difficult to say. There are various estimates whether the recovery will be V-shaped, will be U-shaped, will be L-shaped, Nike-shaped, whatever. But one thing is clear, that it's going to take a minimum of 9 to 12 months for people to find a new normal. We are all looking at when will a vaccine come around for the virus, and that while all the work, good work is going on, is still going to take anywhere between 15 to 18 months before it to be fully effective. And until then, we are going to see maybe multiple attacks of the virus, whether it is now, whether it is 6 months from now in a mutated form. But all that I'm trying to put up here for our takeaway is that the impact of COVID is going to be severe. And I'm not here trying to be a doomsday prophet at all. I'm just trying here to give a proposition of what we need to be alive to as we look at the future. So we are looking at significantly hard times. Hopefully, there'll be some vaccine which will come up sooner. Hopefully, the recovery may be faster, but that's not a scenario we should bank on. That's not the scenario on which we should plan. We should be planning to say, this is with us for time to stay. Let's move on from there and let's look at the business environment. So if this is the global economic environment? How do we see the business environment in India? The one question, of course, is how long to wait for the new normal, whatever that new normal is. And there are various propositions on what that new normal could be. And as you can well appreciate, there are different businesses and the impact of COVID on each one of these businesses is different. You have aviation, you have tourism, you have hospitality, you have entertainment and other businesses, which are very, very significantly impacted. And there are others which are not so much impacted and which may not be impacted even in the near future, whether it is pharma, healthcare, digital economy, and we'll talk a little bit about it as we go along. But I think what we need to take away from this proposition is that we are sort of in the middle of a flood and we are all standing there, and then the waters will recede. And some of our clients will be fully clothed at that time, and some of them will lose part of their clothes. Are we identifying those clients, those businesses, which are going to be in a much better shape? And are we working more and more with them? Can we make that identification? One thing which is going to happen as we go forward is that all businesses are going to look at working capital management. Cash is going to be the king. As you are aware, for example, the House of Tatas is known to have said that we are not looking at any capital expenditure over the next couple of years. And that is only to be expected. People will want to preserve their cash. People will want to say that, yes, we need to survive. We don't know when the revenue stream will pass. We are all aware, for example, of the fact that the government has proposed that even though businesses may not be earning revenue, we got to pay our people without a salary cut. We got to pay, we got to reduce the people, etc. A matter is pending before Supreme Court. But leaving that aside, if our revenues are impacted significantly and our costs are recurring, every organization will want to effectively manage its working capital. And one of the inevitable things of that will be a rationalization of a discretionary spend. Any spend which is considered to be discretionary, something which can be avoided, will be put on a back burner. And the question for all of us is that, is the spend on the services that we render to our clients discretionary? And we'll talk a little bit as we go along as to how to ensure that our services are not regarded as discretionary. Our services are regarded as something which is value-added. But if the services that we render are regarded as discretionary, you can be rest assured that either your fees are going to be chopped off, either your services will be kept back for a point of time, and ensuring that you are not in that zone is something which is going to be very, very critical. We are going to see job losses. We have seen job losses in the USA, where the number has gone now to almost 32 million. And we are seeing similarly job losses in India. And when there are job losses, there is going to be dissatisfaction among employees. So as you deal with your clients, you're going to find a workforce which is not highly motivated, a workforce which is demotivated, and you're going to deal with them to render your services. There's going to be innovation in business models, and I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about it. We'll talk about it as we go along. But really, technology is going to rule the roost. A virtual interaction is going to be the norm. Every business will innovate. Every business in the short term will want to survive. In the medium term, will want to transform itself. And in the long term, it will regrow. And the key here to take away is that most organizations, our clients, the business folks, will be inward looking. They'll be inward looking because they will want to cut expenses. They will want to preserve cash. They will want to ensure that they are renegotiating contracts. They're doing whatever else. And then there are others who will use this as an opportunity to grow, because this is a point of time, as we will talk again later on, where you will be able to acquire businesses cheap. You will be able to make acquisitions which are very useful to you. And again, the point I would like you to leave with is, for the businesses to move from the challenging phase to the opportunity phase, Are you partnering with your clients? Are you one with them? Because if you are able to do that, then you are with the client in the life cycle. You have ridden the client during the challenge phase. You are then with the client when the opportunities arise. And while the client will grab the opportunities, so will you as a service provider. If I had to put briefly as to how do I see opportunities, challenges, and what is going to be the new normal that is going to emerge over a period of time. You know, as many of you would have followed the interaction between the Prime Minister and the Chief Ministers of the state, one of the things with the Prime Minister tabled, and which I think is going to be very, very important, something which India needs to benefit from, is that there is going to be an emotional and an economic backlash against India. Without doubt, there will be opportunities. Japan has openly stated so, and others are stating so, that they cannot put all their eggs in one basket. It cannot be that China will continue to be the factory to the world. People will want to look at alternatives. I'm personally aware, for example, that one of the biggest employers in China, a company by the name of Foxconn, which I'm sure many of you would have heard of, I was interacting with the CEO, and he came back to say that, Dinesh, I have 1.5 million workers in China. 99% of my revenues come from China, and I cannot be manufacturing only in China. I have to come to India. I have to diversify my risk. There is a thought process within the government, and I do hope that India grabs this opportunity, does not score a self goal, and ensures that we are able to provide a red carpet, a less bureaucratic opportunity for people to come in and establish themselves. Clearly, India looks like being less bettered. While the world impact is about 3 million, India is still just 100,000 plus. While the deaths globally are more than 200,000, India is just touching 1,000. So India is less bettered than the world. And the question is, how do we make the most of it? And for us as professionals, again, the question is going to be, how are we readying ourselves that if there are going to be investments coming from elsewhere into India, are we gearing up to talk that language? There'll be an impact on valuation, opportunities to buy, and we'll talk a bit at length as we go along. There are challenges and severe challenges. The challenges include survival at this point of time. There are businesses, make no mistake, which will fall by the wayside. The going concern assumption may not really be valid for all businesses. There's going to be a huge amount of litigation, and we have all heard about it. I don't want to deal at length on this subject of force majeure, but clearly people will want to find ways and means of getting out of contracts which they have made on the basis that in the new reality, the contracts cannot be fulfilled. There's going to be impairment. And I think the biggest impact is going to be MSMEs. For those of us who are working with medium and small enterprises, you will find that they are going to be under very, very significant strain. The larger enterprises, you know, we are all aware, for example, how Reserve Bank of India is trying to inject liquidity in the system. But what we are finding is that while the liquidity has been provided to the banks, the liquidity from the banks is going to and only to AAA rated companies. Banks are very, very wary at this point of time of lending to anybody who is other than AAA. Even AA rated companies are unable to get funds. MSMEs are going to be really, really at a bad end. Sure, there are proposals which are around the corner on how capital can be injected into MSME. If those proposals are appropriately implemented, MSMEs will have some hope, but otherwise they're going to be very, very significantly challenged. We'll talk a little bit as we go along about the new question is going to be the new norm as we are having today. And technology is going to be at the forefront of any business model. I would say that, again, adapting, and that's a mantra I would like to leave with all of you today, is are you able to adapt to the new environment? you know, when you talk about BPOs, for example, in India, when the lockdown happened, there were so many BPOs which, when they had to ensure that people work from home, did not have enough laptops because people work in shifts and they had sort of maybe 50% of the laptops available because people worked on them in shifts. And they were struggling to get laptops and they were struggling to get dongles and whatever is connectivity for their people. And then there were others who were better prepared, who had their connectivity in a very good shape. There were others who really were able to rise to the occasion and satisfy the client's obligations seamlessly working from home. The clients were delighted with those service providers and their business, of course, boomed, while those who took a lot of time to transition out from work from office to work from home lost out. So then that's going to be the new normal. I have left a blurb out there, which is talk about revisiting one's purpose, one strategy. I think we are at a point of time when we need to Sorry, I was just been muted and I've unmuted myself. So one of the things which is very, very critical is each of the business is going to revisit its purpose, what it means in the long term, what is its strategy going to be, and is going to evolve a new direction. Are we as service providers understanding that direction, understanding that new strategy, and are we working with the clients in that? And post COVID, the work protocols are going to change. And again, very, very briefly, we are going to see people more and more work from home. That's going to happen at a client's place. That's going to happen at our place. There's a point of time when we said that the best way to understand a client and the best way to win a client is to be sitting with the client, understanding their needs and sort of relating to them. Going forward, a client is actually going to come back and say, why do you need to come and meet me in my office at all? I would rather have a virtual interaction. There are going to be protocols that if a client visits you or you visit a client, what sort of sanitation will you use? How will the rooms be cleaned up, fumigation happen, et cetera, et cetera. And these are the protocols which each one of us need to start thinking about for our own office, because as and when things start to open up and as and when we can go to our office, we need to put those protocols in place. And we need to be alive that clients are going to have those protocols. And the reason why I talk about these protocols is that I've been speaking to many, many professionals who are in practice and who are, of course, eagerly waiting to say that when can we start going back to the office. But do we realize that even if we start going to the office, we will not be able to operate full-fledged? We will need to keep social distancing. We'll need to have separate protocols on how tea, coffee is offered to clients, et cetera, et cetera. And whilst, of course, there has been this huge amount of dialogue on the television, et cetera, that if you fall foul of the guidelines which have been issued by the ministry, are you likely to be put behind bars? And leaving that political controversy aside, you need to be alive that you need to provide a working environment to your people, which makes them less exposed or not exposed to COVID. You are not going to be part of that. You're going to be sort of ensuring from your side that everything and more that you do is a healthy environment for your people to work. And so will your clients. And therefore, your interaction with the clients is going to undergo a significant change. So let's move on from there and let's go more specific into what do I think is this going to mean to the profession. And the way I look at this is that when you look at the impact on the profession, there are professionals in industry and they will have their own challenges and their own opportunities. And then there are professional firms where we are rendering service to the clients and we will have our own opportunities and challenges. I think before I go to those specifics, you know, as they say that the mantra normally is the survival of the fittest. Here, it's not a question of survival of the fittest. stage where it is going to be survival of those who are able to adapt to the new business environment the fastest. If, for example, we are going to talk about the fact that work from home, at least for the next 12, 18 months, is going to be a reality, we are now not worried about a heavy investment in fancy offices and fancy infrastructure. What we need is to see how are we able to connect up with the clients? How are we able to render services to the client, which a client is asking for? Adapting is going to be the key to survival and, of course, to success. So let's look at professionals in industry. And what are they going to be looking at? There are factors which they will do, which will be internal, inward looking, and there are external factors. As you can appreciate, a CFO, a chartered accountant working in the finance function, tax function, whatever, is going to look internally, as we spoke earlier, about cash management. That's going to be the immediate aim. When we started Manish and Vipul spoke about how companies have been able to finalize their accounts. Those are the listed companies. But there are several other companies unlisted, and all of them are going to be assessing in their accounts the going concern assumptions, the impairments, the inventory write-offs. And there's a strange thing out there that as you look at your tax liability, for example, for March 20, are you going to make provision for potential losses because what you had on 31st March 20 may or may not be realizable, whether it is debtors, whether it is stock going forward, just given the COVID situation. Cost rationalization is going to be the mantra, as I spoke earlier also. And people are going to reassess transfer pricing models. Let me just spend a minute on that. We look at India as now having either subsidiaries of global multinationals or Indian companies itself being multinationals and having associated enterprises around the world. Your pricing model is going to change. So take, for example, that you are an Indian captive BPO and you entered into agreements and you are providing services on a cost plus 18, 19, 20% as is the norm. Are you going to be continuing to provide that? Will you relook at your business model? Look at a situation that a US retailer, take for example, a Macy's. Macy's has furloughed 130,000 employees in the USA. Let's assume they have a back office in India, which they do. And let's assume that has got 10,000 people. Are they going to remunerate that back office on a going forward basis at a cost plus 15 or 18% guaranteed markup, notwithstanding the fact that they are bleeding in USA? The answer is no. And can we think of, and will the professionals in industry start thinking about what are those solutions to that? People are going to reassess their working capital. People will relook at their revenues, cash flows. And while there is a need to be inward looking, there are going to be external issues which are going to come up. People will be looking at effectively raising capital. You've seen, for example, how one of the very large private sector banks has just about announced raising extra capital. Not that they are short of capital at all, but this is sort of planning in advance to say, how am I funded? How am I thinking about the future? I mentioned to you, for example, that with the Reserve Bank putting liquidity into the system, lots of money is available, particularly to highly rated companies, AAA rated companies. And all of them are going to be grabbing that money because they do know that as we go ahead, there are going to be opportunities to consolidate. There'll be other companies in the same business, which are going to be very, very stressed, which are not as well managed as you are, and people will want to sort of consolidate that. People will think of effectively collaborating to provide more value-added services. And folks in industry are going to engage advisors, people to partner them who are able to bring value to the table. I'll talk a little bit about it as we go along as to what do professional services organizations do. But as I see going forward in a situation like what we are at this point of time, CFO will have an extremely, extremely critical role to play on a going forward basis, because he's the one who's going to manage the purses of the organization and both the debit side of the P&L account and the credit side of the balance sheet are going to be extremely, extremely critical. And each one of them will have a role to play, and the CFO will be an important contributor to that role. Let's move to professional services firm. And I would want to spend a few minutes talking about this slide, because I think that's the heart of what I would like to put on the table. We're looking at a new normal. We are looking at a point of time where costs are going to be slashed. As I spoke to you, is your service regarded by the client as a discretionary spend? And if it is a discretionary spend, the cost will be slashed. But leave that aside for a moment. It is a fact of life, and I can vouch this at a ground level. Clients are going to come back, and they will want to either postpone some of the expenditure because some of the projects are going to be kept back, or they're going to ask for significantly lower fees. And the question is that when fees is a dirty letter, cost is a dirty word for a client, how do you, as a professional services organization, which is supposed to be making money, which is supposed to be employing people, which is supposed to be rendering services to the client, going to react to this? You cannot go back and say all the time that these are my fees, take it or leave it. And if you're not going to pay me these fees, I don't want to work for you. That's not how you partner with a client. I have seen situations where, for example, you're talking to a client and a client comes back and says, I am extremely satisfied with your services. I can't see any need for change at all, but I am bleeding. And at this point of time, would you like to please partner me so that I don't look for somebody alternate? Because if you don't partner me, I will have no option to look for an alternative, not because I don't like you, but because I really don't have an option. I need to curtail my cost. So just look at this situation. What were the goals that we had currently as a professional services organization? We may have our targets, our budgets, we want to win on assignments. Are we going to give that up? The answer is no. But probably we now need to be thinking about going long. We need to work with the client to build goodwill, to create impact. Because if we don't do that, somebody else is going to step into that client and we are going to be losers. And that's not what you do as a professional services organization. You work with a client, you partner with a client, you build long-term relationships. Because while what is seen today is hugely negative, it's not going to last. We are going to come out of it. We are going to grow. The country is going to grow. The organizations are going to grow. And if you have partnered with a client in these difficult times, those are the times they will remember that, yes, when we were having trouble, these were the people who stood by us. We want to continue that relationship going forward. And, you know, I ask this question ever so often, that at the end of the day, we got to keep the wheels of the organization going. We need to pay salaries. We might want to renegotiate some part of rent, try to bring the rent cost down, et cetera, et cetera. But we need to get money to run the organization. And as they say, ki ghoda ghas se dosti karega to khayega kya? Sure, I do want to partner with my clients, but in that, how do I, if my client may be bleeding, but how can I afford to bleed? And there are no answers, particularly from a practical point of view. What I have gone and seen is to go and tell a client, okay, you want to reduce my fees at this point of time, I'm happy to partner with you. But can we please have a short-term arrangement for the next 3-4 months until some more certainty comes around? And if things start to look better, can we go back to our normal fees? Or can you go back and tell a client that here I am rendering these services, I can't afford to slash my cost. Why don't we do this? I'm prepared to value add to whatever you are talking about. And in that process, I'm happy to charge you a fixed fee. But if you are satisfied with my services purely at your discretion, then can I look for an incremental fee only as if you are satisfied with what I do? No one answer, no easy answer. But the important thing is that we talk to clients their language. We talk to them the language of business. We understand their pain points. And having understood their pain points, how do we relate to them? How do we invest in that relationship and how we build the goodwill? Without, of course, at any point of time, taking away our eyes on the fact that we are here to run our business, but we are here to run our business, not just for the short term, but also for the medium term and also for the long term. So what will change? One is the way I see it, and this is of course a situation which is not necessarily COVID related. It is always the case, but clients are going to ask for innovative solutions, bespoke solutions. As I see, the profession itself is going to get into maybe two baskets. One is extreme value-add, providing innovative solutions to the client, which a client values and for which a client is willing to pay fees. Another is commoditized things that we would do, where you would actually be into a competition with several people who can render those commoditized services. And when you are rendering those commoditized services, the only issue which you need to be all the time alive to is that, are you evolving a service platform as will ensure that your cost of delivery is de minimis? Therefore, even if you are charging low fees because you have been able to, and we'll talk a little bit about evolving technology platforms, how do you evolve those technology platforms and how are you able to render your services as economically as possible to the client? You know, when you start speaking about innovative and bespoke solution, a question will come up, for example, that this is a point of time when, as we said, a client is going to look at cost optimization. Can you use your skill sets to work with the clients to say how you can help optimize the cost? As I said again, how do you price yourself so that your fees does not become a cost to the client but becomes a value add to the client? An ongoing honest communication with the client, an ongoing ability to relate to the clients is going to be extremely, extremely important. One other thing which we need to think about is that a client is ultimately interested in a solution. On a going forward basis, a client is going to be bleeding or be dealing with a variety of issues. Are you able to pick up an issue for a client? And are you able to provide a solution? And the reason I mentioned this is that many times we think ourselves in silos. When we start thinking of our thing in silos, we may go back and say, you have this problem of which there is a small part, whether it is forensic, whether it is valuation, whether it is tax, and I can take care of it. But that does not really resolve a client's issue. A client's resolution of an issue may require strategizing, studying, implementing, advocacy, and a variety of things. How do we maybe team up with other professionals? How do we go back and tell a client, this is your problem, and this is my holistic solution, which I am happy to implement? Professional services organizations, which are going to be able to team up and provide a holistic solutions to the clients, are going to be the ones which are going to be liked by the clients, are the ones which are going to be valued by the clients, and those are the people who will be able to get their fees on an ongoing basis. Technology is, of course, going to be the mantra, no question about it. And I would break up technology into two parts. Are we as professional service providers imbibing technology? I did speak to you about how BPOs were struggling to get laptops when they had to work from home. Are we ensuring that every single employee of us is able to work on a laptop? Are we reskilling ourselves, each one of us in the profession? And are we reskilling our people such that we are able to be latest with the technology? It's going to be extremely, extremely important because, as I mentioned to you earlier on, this is not a situation that one day the lockdown will be lifted. And when the lockdown is lifted, you will be able to go to the office and start operating from normal. That situation at this point of time, as I said, looks at least 12 to 15 months away. Until that point of time, We are going to have part of the staff who's going to be working from home, part of the staff which is going to be in the office with social distancing and whatever else. Are we thinking technology? Are we creating platforms to render services to our client? Let me be more specific. The way technology has evolved today, there is a huge amount of machine learning. There's so much work that we do for the clients, even on an advisory side, which can be rendered through a machine and which keeps on learning, such that each time you do the next and the next and the next assignment, the machine is able to churn out a solution, which is a base solution, does not substitute the professional, and on which the professional can keep on building up. Makes delivery so much more efficient, so much less costly, and so much more sure that you are not really missing out on something that you need to render to the clients. Developing those technology platforms, clearly, for example, again, when Manish mentioned that audits have happened, you could never have had a situation where you could work from home and do audit unless your own technology platform could interface with the technology platform of the client. Are we as professional services organization, because that's one expenditure which is not going to be regarded as discretionary by us or by our clients, and that is investment in technology. Let me tell you, one of the things which I have seen as I talk to several technology companies, IT enabled companies, they recognize that not all their people are skilled with the technology of tomorrow. Many of them are living in the technology of yesterday. There was always a need for them to ensure that all the people were up to that, or the people who were not adept to the technology of today and tomorrow moved on from the organization. Going forward, they will not have an option because the people who are unable to adapt to that technology might need to move on. One of the very interesting things which happens when you start talking about work from home is that when you are rendering services to the client, your communication has to be very, very high on content. There is a point of time when people were looking for thick 60 slide presentation. If you're doing a restructuring for a client, or if you're doing an acquisition, whatever, you would sort of put multiple options and whatever else. A client today doesn't have time for that. A client is going to come back and say, give me a presentation which may be just 4 slides, but which is extremely high in content, which provides me a solution. And one final thing I just wanted to talk about here, which is the last point on this slide, which is about having diversity at workplace. As a firm, I have seen, and I have seen all the large organizations struggle, that at an entry level, the gender ratio is almost equal. And then as we rise, women folk leave the organizations either to get married, to raise a family, and then they don't come back. And they do not come back, not because they don't want to come back, but because the organizations don't provide that platform, work from home, etc. Some of the larger organizations are very, very specifically focused to say that how can we encourage and get women to sort of be part of us, because after they have moved on, they certainly want to come back. And that's a resource base, trained resource base, which you don't want to lose. There was a point of time when work for home was almost regarded as an excuse for not wanting to work hard, no longer. We are seeing today that when you work from home, the measurement is not hours, but is the output. It's not about what time did you log into the office and what time did you log out. It's really a question of, have we measured what is the output that a person can grant? And working women are absolutely capable of providing that. They might have flexi time, they might work partly, whatever else, but they are trained resources. And I'm very sure that with the evolution of technology, and if we look inside, people who have left us are working, are at home, are currently making home, can we encourage them to come back? And that's going to be very important leverage that we would have. And then, of course, the technology and the opportunities that it provides to professional services organization to render services to the client. Everybody has now bought into that idea that they have no option but to digitize. They have no option but to get into, depending on the type of business, artificial intelligence, etc. And what you are going to see going forward is a demand for professionals who can deal with technology, people who can provide security of data, build firewalls, standardize, automate. It is not that it wasn't there in the past. It is not that people were not conscious of it. But unless you got attacked by a security breach, you didn't bother too much about it. It was somebody else's problem. As we go ahead and we see that people are going to work from home, we'll need increasing amount of security. We'll need increasing amount of sophistication on technology, both on the hardware side and on the software side. The demand for professionals is going to be extremely high there. And if we can focus ourselves on that, we have a great opportunity. Equally, as I mentioned to you, businesses are going to look at cost optimization. And when you start looking at cost optimization, one of the things which you're going to find is that if you have non-core functions, you will want to outsource them if it can be done cheaper rather than doing them in-house. Are we looking at that as an opportunity? Can we sort of take on that responsibility and provide those services to the client? Technology is going to provide significantly. I have just named a few things, but really working with the clients, understanding their business models, helping them evolve their business models such that they are not impacted by a COVID-like situation, God forbid, if that should happen tomorrow, is going to be something which is going to be core. As I said, Manish, Vipul both spoke about audit profession, and the audit profession has adapted very, very significantly. Challenges, as I spoke earlier, you are looking at a situation where the larger companies, and I have spoken to many of those companies, there have been complaints, et cetera, leave that out for a moment. But really, larger companies have sort of moved on, but there are medium-sized companies, there are smaller companies where we are going to have challenges in trying to ensure that we are able to complete audit in time. But more important than the audit is the issue regarding verification, is an issue regarding going concern, is an issue regarding what do you qualify and what do you not qualify, and how do you look at audit evidence on a going forward basis. A subject in itself, but the way I would look at it is that all of us need to recognize on a going forward basis that as auditors, we need to be creating a record now, which is far more better electronic than it ever was. If we are doing an audit working from home, if we are going to sign off those accounts, the evidence that we will need will be of a higher order. Our ability to use our technology consistent with the client, as I had mentioned earlier, a technology platform which interfaces with the client's technical platform, is able to pull in data, is going to be extremely, extremely critical. One of the things which is going to be extremely, extremely important on a going forward basis is, as I mentioned to you earlier, there is going to be a stress in the system. There are going to be opportunities for acquisition in the system. And I think this is one area of professional practice which is going to boom as we go ahead. And I can see three parts to it. There's going to be bankruptcy, there's going to be restructuring, and there's going to be acquisition opportunities. We are looking, for example, the government having given a moratorium for the need to go to IBC. But as time goes by, that time will go. And again, question is, are there organizations which are now going to go into IBC? More important, as we are all aware, over the last few months, debt restructuring through tripartite arrangement without going to IBC has become the norm. Can we work with a client to help in those negotiations and see how one can evolve a situation which is tripartite and where one doesn't need to go through bankruptcy. Again, forensic is going to be a very, very important business. As you know, the moment you go to IBC, there is a need for a forensic report. Even if you are doing an OTC with a bank, forensic becomes very, very important. Again, a business which I see having immense potential as we go ahead. And if your client is undergoing stress and is likely to go for a bankruptcy, are there issues on cost rationalization? Are there things which a client is going to look at that point of time to ensure that they don't go for bankruptcy? Again, huge amount of work, huge amount of opportunities as we go ahead. When you talk of restructuring, and this is where a company may not be ready to go for an IBC, has some stress, and it is a liquidity stress, but not a solvency stress. Number of things. Are there group reorganizations which one can do, where one can mobilize and use group cash surpluses? Is there a tax leverage out there where you have a profit-making and a loss-making company and you can sort of minimize your tax outgo by restructuring? At a time of stress, one thing which becomes very, very important is that promoters and entrepreneurs are going to be extremely concerned about their personal wealth. Succession planning, of course, is one part, but how do you make your personal assets, hard-earned personal assets, bankruptcy remote? What do you need to do to ensure that just because you have 2 years of a COVID-like situation, your lifetime earnings are not at risk? Again, going to be a very, very important issue. We are all aware, for example, how the stock market has evolved, how the prices of shares have gone down. Are we working with the promoters to help them with the creeping acquisitions, voluntary open offer, buybacks, etc., to ensure that those are done in a tax-effective manner, they are done in a cost-effective manner, and one is able to sort of take advantage of the current situation? Acquisitions are going to be huge. We saw the government press note in the context of investments which are coming from countries, neighboring countries, which have a land attached to our land, our borders. But clearly, private equities who have got gunpowder at this point of time, who have raised funds at this point of time, will be out looking at acquisitions. That's what happened in 2008, and that's what's going to happen today. I was talking to a private equity, which is from India, and I was talking to the CEO, and she mentioned how just fortuitously she happened to close a fund just about a fortnight before the whole thing broke out and the lockdown happened, and it raised $600 million, and how she was looking at making investment. I was talking to another private equity, and which has raised a multi-billion dollar global raise, which includes a substantial portion for Asia and India, and how are they going to be looking at it? Equally, when you're looking at acquisitions, you're going to see renegotiations. I'm aware of several transactions which are signed or a term sheet has been agreed to, where people are looking at moving out, whether using force majeure or whatever else. And those are going to be renegotiated. They're without doubt going to be renegotiated. And we as professional service providers could be on either side. We could be working with our clients who need to raise money from private equity, help them negotiate, help get a better value, or working with private equity to ensure how deals can happen and how deals are attractive and is a win-win for both sides. So again, substantial amount of opportunity out here. One thing which is going to happen, as I mentioned to you, is that clients are going to need holistic solution. And those solutions might not be just the advice that we are giving to the client. That could include need for an external intervention. And this could be in variety of ways. For example, there are several situations. Today, the other day, I was dealing with a client, which is a listed company, and where warrants had been issued to promoters. and those warrants had been issued at a particular price and had to be exercised at a particular point of time. And the question was, could you sit down with SEBI and the regulators and explain to them why, given the COVID situation, those warrants need to be restructured? Are you in a position to work with your clients, work with the regulators? Are you willing to think back and reflect that just because the law says X or Y or Z and looks like a non-negotiable, we do not accept it as a non-negotiable, but we engage with the regulators. It could be Reserve Bank of India, as you know, again, a Reserve Bank, for example, has extended the time limit for realization of export dues from 6 months to 15 months. Are there other things that we need to do? A subject which is dear to my heart, taxes. I just put a point out here that at a point of time when one is talking about COVID, will tax planning be something which will be extremely frowned upon? We had a storm in the teacup the other day when a group of young IRS officers came up with a position paper on what should be done to raise taxes, be it in imposition of inheritance tax, be it levy of wealth tax, be it whatever else. But those opportunities will keep on coming up. We have seen how courts have started working electronically. I was talking to the president and the vice president of the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, and they are trying to evolve ways and means that how they can again function electronically. Are we prepared for that? Are we having the wherewithal to say that if evidence has to be filed, book has to be filed before the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal or whoever authority, how does it get done electronically? How is evidence done electronically? But overall, the interaction with the regulators and working with a client to make things happen is going to be extremely, extremely critical. And with that, I come to my final slide. And I'm just trying to summarize the thoughts that I have laid before you thus far. At the heart of all of it is, are we thinking all the time that we need to add value? It's extremely, extremely critical that a client does not see us as a cost, but a client sees us as somebody who's adding value. Anything that you talk about talking value to the client, be it in terms of a cost optimization structure, be it in terms of helping client on technology, be it in terms of helping client on forensic or whatever else, a client is going to perceive in the right manner. And if a client perceives that in a right manner, you are going to be engaged, you are going to be paid your fees. Always think value add. That is heart and central to everything that we are talking about. I mentioned to you about the need to quickly adapt. And I can't overemphasize that. This is a point of time when large being large is not necessarily the best thing to do, because the larger you are as an organization, there are so many more things that you need to factor before you can make a change. Smaller organizations can be far, far fleet-footed, can think on their feet, can optimize costs. More important, can optimize, can recalibrate their service offerings, can react to the clients far, far more quickly and in a better way than large organizations are. I think we should stop worrying about this distinction between large and small organizations. I would want to leave it to all of us to say that, are we really just understanding the new reality and relating to the client, talking to the client on an ongoing basis? Imbibing technology, I spoke a lot about it and I can't emphasize it more. Each one of us needs to know that technology is the way forward. We need to invest in technology. Clients are going to invest in technology. We got to imbibe technology wholeheartedly. That's the way forward. Nothing can be more important than that. Upskill yourself. And, you know, we are all aware, for example, that we have webinars going all across. I was reading some of those humor on the social media talking about not yet another webinar. But let me tell you, there is really no end to upskilling yourself. We as chartered accountants need to think business, need to not think in silos, as I mentioned earlier. Are we broad-basing our thought process, not only within the narrow vertical in which we are operating, where of course we need to upskill ourselves very, very significantly so that we are deep down there, know everything in the vertical in which we are specialist. But more important, are we broad-basing, getting understanding of economics, getting understanding of legal jargons? A force majeure may certainly not be a chartered accountant's cup of tea. It's a cup of tea which is meant for lawyers. And sure, a client is not going to come to us to discuss force majeure and ask us whether something needs to be litigated or not litigated. But if you are a chartered accountant and advising a client, whether it is on audit or tax or a forensic or whatever else, and you are unable to talk force majeure with a client is not going to value what you are talking about because that becomes integral part. So are you upskilling yourself? Are you upskilling all your employees? Are you not looking expenditure on upskilling as something which is a dispensable cost? And finally, as I mentioned, focus on long-term relationship. I think it's extremely, extremely important. We all get carried away by the short term. As I mentioned to you, we all have got organizations to run, salaries to pay, rent to pay, overheads to meet. But when a client is bleeding, probably there needs to be a think back to say, how can I partner with the client? How do I build long-term relationships? Because I know that this client and this relationship is going to mean a lot. And when the tide turns, I need to be the person who's going to sort of work with the client and ensure that the client is successful and I am successful with the client. With that, I complete my presentation and hand over back to the moderators. And if you could just look at the questions and any questions need to be answered, please let me know.
Thank you. Thank you, Dinesh Bhai, for this excellent presentation, I believe. I also agree that, you know, our fate will depend upon the client's fate. So therefore, yes, there are certain questions and doubts raised post-COVID, how our clients will react to the environment, changing environment. But also at the same time, you mentioned about so many opportunities, people looking out of China and coming into India. So provided India keeps that floodgates open. So two important points. One, for me was the use of technology, upgrading ourselves and focus on long-term relationship with clients. I think so these were the two important takeaways for me personally. And I would just request, Chirag to, you know, ask the questions that our online viewers have sent. Chirag, you can ask the question. Yeah.
Sure. So it was a very interactive, I think the session, a lot of questions have been asked online. I will put them across subject to the time availabilities. So the first one is for adversely impacted sectors. Whether carryback of business losses is under consideration by Finance Ministry. Any thoughts on this?
It's a very interesting question. And I wish, like some of the countries like USA, India also had a carrybackward of losses. And there doesn't appear to be any such thought process at all at this point of time. However, as I mentioned earlier, you have paid your taxes for the year ended 31st March 20. How are your accounts for March 20 drawn up? You are a listed company, you may have different prerogatives. You are an unlisted company, you may have different prerogatives and approach. But are there write-downs that you need to do, which you might as well do today rather than waiting? And I'm talking about what can be done within the purview of accounting standards. So can you relook very closely at your debtors, your realization, your stocks, your other assets, and wherever necessary, write them down, for example, for March 20 itself, and look at to say, is there a refund which is due to you for that year? So you could do things which can help you sort of carry backward that losses, but there doesn't appear to be any thought process from whatever I know in my interaction with the government to permit really a legal carry backward of losses. But a very interesting question.
So the other question is that there are a lot of news that, a lot of international companies are moving out of China. But how, when we see today that maximum are moving to Vietnam or Taiwan, very few companies have made news, that it's going to move to India. But what major changes do you expect in ODI or fast track or setting up of businesses, tax rebates, infrastructures like this in India for these entities to move here?
Let me put it this way. This is a battle for India to lose. Nobody else can lose. It's up to us to grab this opportunity. India took a step forward, for example, September last, when we came and said that new manufacturing companies will have a 15% rate of tax from 1st October 19, if it's a new manufacturing facility, etc. But that's just one part. Tax is, of course, very important. A 15% rate of tax is as competitive as it can ever get. But there needs to be an overall business environment. As I have seen, companies wanting to set up manufacturing facilities will want maybe manufacturing zones, availability of land, availability of power, a single point clearance, and assurance that they are not going to face labor unrest. So a number of things need to fall in place. Vietnam and others, of course, are again smaller countries and are doing their best. But the key is that they don't have the scale which India can provide. India has this unique ability not only to be a market for self-consumption, but also a market where labor of a very high order is available, which not many other countries can provide. I think the question is, will India rise to the occasion? You know, we have spoken about this from 1991, single window clearance. And a single window clearance never comes. We talk about power projects, and then there'll be a environmental clearance, a state level, a center level, and everybody's sort of squabbling amongst each other. The question is, can India put its act together? Can it work? The states and the center work together to attract investment. If that happens, I can actually see quite a bit of companies moving here. And for us as professionals, really the challenge is, how do we provide those holistic services, whether it's in terms of setting up of entities, finding the right location, helping prepare business plans, liaisoning with the government, whatever else.
Good. So the another question is on what opportunity do you see for freelancing professionals, consultants in our profession? Specifically, a lot of things going online, or you see a model like pay by hour kind of consultation models and stuff now going on with a lot of outsourcing things also in the pipeline and stuff?
You know, there will always be different opportunities. I heard a business model which has become reasonably successful in the USA. Law firms in USA are pretty, pretty demanding. People end up spending whatever 70, 80 hours a week in the office. And many of the partners in the large law firms actually burn out by the time they are 45, 50 years, and then they retire. And of course, after they retire, they like to go to Bahamas and Honolulu for a couple of years, but then there's so much that you can do and you want to get back to your profession. And many of them work like freelancers, as you asked the question, and are able to provide on-call services. Will people have those opportunities in India? The answer is absolutely yes, because freelancers have one of the best advantages, which is that they don't have too much of fixed cost. They don't need to have an office. They don't need to have an infrastructure. What is necessary, however, is that these people need to have very specific skill sets. And those skill sets need to be such that a client wants to talk to them. They are able to add that distinctive value. Or it could be simply their availability when the need arises, or it could simply be a cost arbitrage. But there has to be some uniqueness there which allows them to be very successful.
Sir, in terms of collaboration, you mentioned, there is a question that can you suggest some few model or an example of CA firms collaborating together and having a win-win situation, like a pan-India approach, or how do they consolidate?
Yeah, so take this example which I gave you earlier, that you are looking at a US mid-sized company wanting to set up a manufacturing base in India. And the moment you say that they want to set up a manufacturing base in India, they might want a host of services, right from trying to locate the right state, negotiate the right incentive structure on a state side, make choices in terms of GST, looking at bank financing, tons and tons of things, tax structuring, legal, whatever. And the ordinary approach that they would want to have is that, can I go to a single service provider? I'm not talking of legal services, which for somebody would go to a law firm, but other services which can be provided by chartered accountants. There are larger firms who maybe have got a multidisciplinary approach and can therefore take care of all of this. For other firms, to start all of these services under one roof may prove to be a very difficult investment to make, because not everything yields results immediately. And the question is, can firms with complementary skills, somebody has a good ability to do a project report and look at bank financing, somebody else has got an ability to do something else, can people come together to collaborate, work with each other and approach a client together? It's very important that when people come together and collaborate, there has to be a value system, a quality base, and an agreement that how do you work seamlessly with a client. That's where things start falling through the cracks. But if you are able to find that, so that is one example. The other, of course, is the person who asked the question put it, working geographically. But geography is one of the easiest things to talk about. What I am talking about is putting disciplines which otherwise you would not have under one roof, being able to collaborate and providing a single face to the client to render the services.
So when we said that we move to an IT environment in our professions and involve a huge cost also to move, but there are certain challenges which today people are facing is in terms of clients are reluctant to share their data online, especially in consulting or internal audit assignments. How do we cope up with these scenarios?
So again, I think a very, very interesting question, a very a relevant and practical question. Why is it that a client is reluctant to share the data online if the same data is needed for the purpose of an internal audit and is provided to you when you are carrying out that audit physically at a client location? Why is it that a client would hesitate to provide online? And one of the key things is security of data. Is the client sure that there is a security of data, that the systems that you as a service provider have are sufficiently robust enough such that there is no leakage of data? Are we maintaining the protocols within the organization to put firewalls around the data? All those things. And you know, you began the question talking about cost of technology. I think the way technology is evolving, costs are significantly going down. I'm not saying that it's cheap, but I'm saying that the cost is going down. And there are things, again, which you can do today, which you would never have done in the past, which at a relatively cost-effective manner. Putting those systems, giving an assurance to the client that the data is in a safe environment, that is going to reach only those people whom it is supposed to, that there are sufficient NDAs and everything signed, that's the way to go forward.
Right. The other one was with this all things coming up, where you said one thing about partnering with your client in terms of fees or cost. How long do you see this, or do you see this as a change in the model itself of working, or it's a short-term model where we partner with the profession because there is a lot of outstanding always there, plus we partner with the clients. So... how do you see this?
I wish I had an answer. As I mentioned in my first slide, that I see this as a reasonably long-term pain. I don't think the situation is going to remedy itself in the next few weeks or months. That pain is going to remain with the client. Now, will it result in everything being rebased? So for example, our salary is likely to undergo a downward thing. You know, in India, over the last 20 years, we've only seen salaries, fees, everything go up, up and up. Rentals go up, up and up. We have never seen what it means to have a plateauing or a downturn. I don't know. That's what over a period of time, we'll get to know where does this focus on. But what I was talking mainly in terms of talking about partnering with a client really is to go back and say that a client has certain needs. That is a fact. The client believes that you are the right service provider for those needs. But the client is under a cost constraint at this point of time. And the question is two things. Can you be with the client at this point of time? And B, can you put fee structures as a result of which a client has a comfort to say that there is a value at the end of the day and he's paying for the value? No easy answers there.
On a similar line, the question was also there that do we see a profession moving towards, except the stat audit, obviously, moving towards the success fee or milestone-based payments? You know, there we initially cover only our fixed cost and the margins are on the success-based. Do we see that as a huge movement in that model?
We have an inherent limitation, which we got to recognize, honor and accept on charging success fees. So the institute itself prohibits charging of success fees, and I do not think anything that we should do or talk about which is inconsistent with what is our obligation. What I was talking about was slightly different or materially different. You could always go and tell a client that I am doing this work for you. So let's say I'll give a practical example to illustrate what I was saying. Let's say we are looking at a cost reduction study, and we have done a cost reduction study for a client 2 years back, 3 years back, we charge a particular fee. Now we are going to do this again. And you go and tell a client, this is my fees. And the client comes and says, sorry, but I'm going to pay you only 50% of the fees. And you come back and say, but you already paid me in the past. And he'll say, forget that in the past. That's history. You come back and say, my cost is the same. In fact, my cost has gone up. Can you go back and tell a client, and I'm not talking about a success fee at all, to say, okay, I'm willing to do this for price X, not 50, but say 65% of whatever I charge you earlier. The balance 35 is a satisfaction fee, which I leave to your discretion. If I'm able to demonstrate to you that, yes, I've been very successful in getting you great opportunities to economize on the cost, then purely at your discretion, you are free to pay me 0 to 35 as you want. And again, I'm saying it's not no one size fits all. But a client may come back and say, yes, I'm willing to consider that so long as you are not going to question me on it.
Sir, I think the question for the last question is that with seeing all those changes, and the importance of chartered accountant we saw in this today's session, like for even framing new entities, for supporting the industry, supporting the laws which are going to be changed to the authorities. The question is that should our profession be now considered as the most essential services in today's scenario?
I don't know whether that question is in the context of the request that was made to recognize us as an essential service. Leaving the regulatory part of it aside, are we essential to a client or not? Depends purely on us. If we are able to, as I said, deliver value to the client, if a client is looking upon us as an essential partner in his business, and client considers it to be essential that yes, he cannot make a decision without talking to us, then we are essential, otherwise we are not.
I think just one last question which has just come up. I'll just read that. What do you foresee changes in risk management and independence norms considering all this? Like consulting and audit, the two piece which comes together to grow. So any changes which do you expect in these norms?
I don't think I have necessarily understood the thrust of that question. Risk consultancy is going to be extremely, extremely important. A risk-based assessment of systems for a client is going to be very, very critical. That's not going to go away at all, because that's a part of your overall corporate governance. That's a part of your risk mitigation as an organization, and everybody will want to have it.
I think a lot of interesting questions and so wonderfully answered with some practical scenarios by you.
Gave a lot of clarity for the generations here. I would now request Sameer Bhai to propose a hearty vote of thanks on behalf of Bombay Chartered Accountants Society and the Chamber of Tax Consultants.
Thank you, Chirag. Very good afternoon to all the participants. I'm happy to announce that there were over 500 participants who had joined today's webinar. That shows the popularity of Mr. Kanabar as a speaker and as a domain expert on the subject. Before I propose the vote of thanks, I would first want to request all the participants that in case you have not renewed your membership for BCS and for the Chamber of Tax Consultants, request you to kindly renew your membership for the year 2021. Apart
and
from that,
should not be regarded, and that should not be regarded as a discretionary spend. That should be well worth it as an essential service.
So I was actually taking it as an essential service, and I thought so did everybody. So, and I'm sure people would have realized over a period of time in the last 4 or 5 weeks that despite being at home, the zeal and the thirst to engage with people, to learn from experts and to increase our own knowledge is something that is not going to go away, be it with Corona or be it with anything else. As human beings and as professionals, this is something that is we imbibe, and it is the, I would say, the main thing that keeps us going forever. Coming to the pleasant vote of pleasant task of giving a vote of thanks, Mr. Kanabar has shared a lot of insights. He has shared a lot of his experience, and in these unprecedented times of a lockdown, which is being faced by not only citizens of India but is being faced worldwide, where millions and millions of people are affected. Several people are in need of medical services and emergency facilities. And there are several considerations which come to mind, but one of the main considerations that we are focusing on is that what comes after COVID? We have to survive, we have to move on. And in order to do that, what do we need? What do we need to look at? How do we cope with it? How do we adapt? Dinesh Bhai, in this in his talk, Dinesh Bhai spoke about how COVID and the ensuing lockdown has been a black swan event, and he touched upon several aspects that we need to focus on, and more importantly, he spoke about those issues that we need to deal with and those things that we can do in order to deal with the things which will come after the lockdown has been withdrawn. One of the most important things that Mr. Kanabar pointed out was that we now need to go long. We need to invest in the future, because whatever may happen after the lockdown, things will not come back to normal in a day, in a week, in a month. They may take several months. They may probably take years also. Having said that, the most important thing will be that we first need to invest in ourselves. When we say invest in ourselves, we'll have to reskill, we'll have to become adaptable, we'll have to learn and adapt to using new technologies. Apart from that, we will also be required to look at what is going around us. We'll have to ensure that we partner with clients, with the business, with the government, with our employees. because at the end of the day, each and every person is a stakeholder in the entire ecosystem, and one without the other is not going to be able to survive. Mr. Kanabar touched upon several opportunities when we talk about risk assessment, risk management, and risk advisory. How to use technology to ensure that there is mobility, and to take a lesson from COVID and ensure that going forward, come what may, business continuity is maintained and there is a plan, plan B, a plan C, so that we can assure our clients that we are always available. For this, we need a strategy. We need to interact. We need to collaborate. It may be with people in the same profession. It may be with people with parallel and like professionals. Most importantly, as a long-term measure, we need to be very, very aware about the fact that in order to weather out this storm, one very painful decision which is likely to come to the front is that there is going to be a conservation of cash and conservation of resources. We need to be prepared for that. And instead of being worried about how we will cope with this effort, what we should look at is how we can engage with our clients and how we can engage with people around us to ensure that our services are truly taken to be essential and not discretionary. With that, I would like to propose a very, very hearty and well-deserved vote of thanks to Mr. Kanabar. Sir, we are very thankful to you that you took out your time and you addressed all of us. Thank you so much on behalf of Bombay Chartered Accountants Society and the Chamber of Tax Consultants.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dinesh Bhai.